Howdy folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas, and today I'm filming in West Texas, right along the US-Mexico border. Gonna be seeking out some history and some old ghost towns, starting with Terlingua. Terlingua is, can't really call it a true ghost town. There are definitely people that still live here today. But back in the day, this was a town that mined cinnabar, which was the substance that led to something called quicksilver, as they used to call it, mercury. And this town still has some of its old charm, like the Starlight Theater restaurant and bar. Now, I knew it wouldn't be open when I got here, but I hear it's a cool place to check out. This is not gonna be the only stop on this tour. We're gonna see quite a few things, but starting here in Terlingua, heading up north along the Rio Grande, up towards Marfa, where I'm gonna be spending the night tonight. So we're gonna stop and see some cool history along the way. Gonna focus on the history, but a lot of these towns have a lot of cool artsy stuff to check out too, as you've already seen probably. And this is a cool town. You start to see a lot of old adobe structures mixed in with this really artsy cool community out here in West Texas. I like this. I read about this also, the Terlingua Jail. And it's a one-room jail, and you can go inside of it. So, really good way to start off our tour. Oh wow, this is tiny. I thought it was gonna be bigger than this, but I think this is a real old jail. And not much to it, other than some graffiti. And boy, would it be hot. You can see the prisoners love to smoke in here. Lots of cigarette butts all over the floor. Let me out of here. Old Joe's smoking up a storm in here. I wonder what's stored inside of that today. Maybe that's where they keep the cigarettes that they smoke in the Terlingua jail. So it would have probably sucked to have been a miner here mining cinnabar, a very toxic material. The source of mercury, and I read that these guys, some of them would have to work like furnaces and things like that, burning this really toxic stuff. So cinnabar, it's not a breakfast bar. It's something you don't want to mess around with. Here's another really well-preserved automobile from an age long gone. It's an old Ford. I only know that because it says so. And I imagine this was once somebody's home. Lots of structures like this. There doesn't seem to be too many rules in this town, so I imagine I can go step inside this thing, but what I want to know is, why is this doorway so short? You can still see some of the original wood inside of this particular structure. And let's see what we got inside here, if I don't kill myself getting in. Oh yeah, nice little one room something. I ain't quite sure. Not quite sure what that is either. All over the place are old rusty cans and things from an era long gone, most likely. You could see some of these cans did not have pop tops or anything like that. No discernible writing on that either. I'm gonna leave this where I found it, although now it's standing up. yeah, there's all sorts of cool artifacts all over the place back here. Although I'm not on federal land, to my knowledge. And federal laws prohibit people from removing artifacts from the premises. My policy is to show the same respect no matter where I'm at. One interesting thought is, imagine if you could go back in time, maybe, I'm gonna guess, the early 1900s, when people toiled here, probably lived a rough life dealing with toxic materials. And if I went back in time like Bill and Ted style in a phone booth and snagged somebody from back then, transported them to now, and they could hear me talking about these old rusty cans as being artifacts, I wonder what the heck they would think. You know, as far as ghost towns go in Texas, I was reading that this is considered one of the premier ghost towns in the entire state. And I can, you know, you guys have been watching my channel for a while, you know that I love me a good ghost town, and we've been to many. And this place has a certain charm. The artistic stuff aside, just having all these buildings like this, one after another, it really lets you fill out and use your imagination as to what this place may have been like and how many people actually lived here. And anywhere you look on the landscape, seems like you'll see foundations like this all over the place. My guess is that the mining operation was up on that hill where you see all that waste rock, or at least one of the mining operations. I don't know how many mines they had out here, but I just noticed that big pile of tailings. Ah, so this is a mine. This is basically saying that they plugged most of the mines in the area, but they left this one unplugged and put a grate over it. So we can hopefully stand over that. Oh, wow. Look at those old timbers in there. I don't know if you guys can see that. Not the best lighting right here, but that goes down further than I can see. And there's an old cage, the device that would have carried miners down. So I'm sure that goes down hundreds of feet easily. And this is a really awesome old relic, well preserved out here in the dry desert. I read that this place is pretty hopping up until around the 1930s, when mercury started to lose its value and then everything dried up. Such is the story with mining towns. We've seen so much of that. Gold, silver, quicksilver, you name it. There's another good view of that hillside that I was exploring earlier, and just look how many structures are there, or the remains thereof. Here we are at Terlingua Cemetery, established in 1902. Here is a tribute to the men and women that worked in this area back in the day. And it does mention that most of the people in this cemetery, or a lot of them, died from the Spanish flu in 1918 and 1919. So I guess that's probably the leading cause of death here, but other people were injured in the mines, exposed to toxic agents, as I told you guys. Oh, I just wish I had more time to explore this. This is something special here. This is the most aesthetically pleasing cemetery I've ever seen. Like something historic like this in a ghost town, I should qualify with that. It's usually, a lot of the cemeteries we visit, as you've seen, are usually just have become small piles of rocks, not big structures like this. Many of which with even no headstones anymore, just bumps in the ground where you can figure out where people were buried. This is a little different over here. And I love it because the wood does seem to be just the original stuff, not restored. And it's just so dry out here that it stands the test of time. And none of these markers are discernible. So I don't know if these people's names are just lost to time now or what. The land of wooden crosses, as far as you can see. Oftentimes on my adventures, you know, I really don't do intense research. Sometimes I do. I did not on this trip. I just read enough to know this is a pretty well-regarded ghost town, and now I know why. So today's more about scouting out things, maybe to come back in the future, because I can tell you I could have easily made a whole video on this place, no problem. But we do have to continue, that we do have a lot more to see and a lot of ground to cover today. So let's hop back in the car and let's head north. West Texas is something spectacular. One of my favorite areas in the country now, I would say. Haven't really had too much time out here. I've been out this way one other time, but not as far south as I've gone this time. Big Bend in this area is very inaccessible for many people, very isolated. And you can see there's really nobody riding on the road over here. Terlingua had a few folks, but the further out I go, the less people I see and the less populated it becomes. But yeah, West Texas is on par with New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, California, Utah, all the stuff that I love. I really don't think about Texas too often when I think of natural beauty. I've been to San Antonio, Austin, and those areas are nice and all, but you know, they don't have the dramatic scenery like you do out here in West Texas. So definitely a worthy chapter in our travels in the American Southwest. And this is another thing on my way that I wanted to see is the Lajitas Cemetery. Lajitas is the Spanish word for flagstone. So this is a lot smaller than the Terlingua Cemetery. I honestly didn't know the Terlingua Cemetery was there. And I had seen a couple of these graves here that looked interesting. Well, now that I know Terlingua, that's got this place beat in terms of beauty, I would say. But still, same idea, same style. A lot of these people are, this is more of the ghost town thing that I've been telling you guys about, where you really don't see any monuments or headstones, just piles of rocks, because the headstones have been eroded with time. I love me a good old cemetery, and yeah, these cemeteries out here in West Texas are something else. Really pretty. These are probably some of the more recent residents here. This guy died in 1995, but was born in 1927. And this one died in 2020. So very recent additions here. I'm gonna guess they have relatives that lived and died out here in West Texas. All right, so the next stop on our tour of the history of West Texas, ghost towns and such, is a place called Fort Leaton, which I think is part of Big Bend Ranch State Park, but it's supposed to be one of the best preserved adobe structures in existence in the American Southwest, so had to come stop and check this out. And it's on the way. And check this out, it's basically, this confirms what I was saying, this is the best preserved and largest fortified adobe building in the American Southwest, or I guess collection of buildings. And here's a map of the area. There's a trail that we can do. It looks like we're gonna go into the fort, and then it looks like we have other options for trails, so we'll have to kind of check on time. This might be a quick one, but I definitely want to check out this fort. For some reason, I have a vision that this is gonna be like some old West movie, like set or something, even though this is a real structure, but the kind of thing I would have thought of or associated with here when I think of like a fort in West Texas. Wow, this is a fort. Those walls are tall. I don't know much about this, to be honest. I didn't even have it on my radar until a ranger recommended it. So I'm so glad that I took her up on that, because this is impressive so far. Look at that gigantic door. So I think the intent of this fort was to protect trade routes in the mid-1800s into the late 1800s. There were a lot of Indians, natives in this area, Apache and Comanche, that were very much threats, very aggressive. And like the Comanche especially, very skilled horse riders. So I assume that's why they needed forts like this, was to protect trade in this region, because there were a lot of valuable resources that came out of this place. And you can actually see on the inside what I assume are the original adobe bricks of the fort. I don't want to damage any of that. That is really neat. This room was a servant's quarters. And look at that, look up at the top. You can actually see stucco on top of these adobe bricks. That's fantastic. Even the floor is interesting. You've got like little interludes of brick of some sort, followed by, I don't know if that's just hard mud. That's what it appears to be. Followed by more brick. This is amazing. Another observation I have is it is hot out there, probably approaching 100 now. And it is warm in here. I mean, compared to living in our air-conditioned homes, this is not as comfortable, but compared to being out there, this is doable. If you had to live out here, I think you could survive happily in here. So I was in here and I keep smelling the smell of like urine or some kind of slightly unpleasant odor. And I was like, maybe it's just the old thing. Well, there's a sign explaining what it is. Bats. Apparently they like to roost up there. All I see are wasps. So there would have been a lot of dances here, apparently. And overall, just having a good old time. And this is a lot nicer in here. I don't know if this is like representative of the original state of this, like the walls being white like that. Whereas over there we saw more of the raw innards of this place. I'm looking for bats. I love these kind of old forts that are like have open courtyards in the middle like this. Very reminiscent. I remember I used to love this video game called Red Dead Revolver. What was the first one called? Anyway, like I remember there was a fort in a game and it was like, I wonder if this was the inspiration maybe for that. And this might be more of the original quarters. Let's head off into this cool room. Wow. This room just smells like old, musty wood. The smell in here is kind of pleasant. This is the dining room, by the way. Not where the servants probably ate. It's a little dark in here too. I love the chandeliers. They have like actual candles in them, just like it would have been. It'd be really cool to see those lit. Some of those are real candles and some of the wicks appear to be blackened. So I wonder if they do occasionally light them. Oh, and this is neat. This is like a family sitting room. You can kind of step down here, it looks like, and you know, this is kind of barred off, but it's kind of a creepy looking dress. Very goth. This area is known as the trading office. I assume where trade happened. So it sounds like Ben Leighton, the guy that really helped found this, may have done business deals with other traders in the area in this very room. Imagine people like in the late 1840s into the 1850s, probably with big mutton chop looks and just the way they would dress, like pioneer stuff, hanging out in this room, the same room that we're standing in now. If we could only just go back in time and see that. I almost feel like I'm in prison here, but we are looking out towards Mexico. I believe, if my sense of direction is correct, like that hill out in the background is probably Mexico. I believe the Rio Grande is out there, not too far away. But yeah, we're walking out towards the kitchen and I assume that's a gigantic fireplace. There's wasps in here too. Amy doesn't like wasps. But if you don't move, they don't bother you. Anywho, yeah, look at all the cool stuff in here. I'm gonna guess some of this is original. I don't know how much is, or, but I'm getting creeped out by these wasps. See ya. This is the bakery where they apparently made wood-fired pizzas back in the day. We're gonna go on the outside really quick, but this is a humongous oven. It's quite impressive. Let me show you this. Like, we'll swing around this way, back into the hot Chihuahuan sun. And that's like how far back that thing goes. You can make a lot of wood-fired pizzas in that. Yeah, this is cool out here in this courtyard. It really opened up and you can really see at times the original adobe poking through the stucco or whatever that is that they put on that. And over there you got completely exposed adobe, probably melting away with each infrequent rainstorm they get back here. Oh my God, what the heck is this? I've never seen anything quite like that. That's huge. That is enormous. What kind of beast could pull something like that? It'd have to be like a 20 mule team or something. All right, back into the hot Chihuahuan desert. I'm gonna have to come back to this area of the country and do a lot more research and tell more stories in the future. So, but every once in a while when you go to a new area that you'd never been to, you kind of just gotta take it in, not really have much of a plan. Just get in there and see it. That's my philosophy. We've made it to yet another West Texas ghost town. This is the town of Shafter, named after William R. Shafter, who was actually a decorated Civil War veteran. And this is the remnants of a Texas silver rush from the 1880s. So yeah, just like California had its silver rush, Nevada, Texas had it too, probably around the same time. Very reminiscent of things we saw in Terlingua earlier too, like the same style of building out here. But let's walk over this ways and see if we can kind of get a closer look. I really wish we could get up in there. But this might just have to do. We'll kind of scour the town for some other stuff. I don't know what this was, if this was part of the mining operation or if these were was a residential area. That's really cool. William Shafter was actually nicknamed Pecos Bill after the legendary folklore hero Pecos Bill. So quite an honor, I would say, to be named after something like that. It's like calling someone Paul Bunyan. I think I read something in maybe the 20, something in the 2000s, the population was like 11 or something like that. But yeah, I think barely anyone lives here. At its height, Shafter actually had about 4,000 citizens. So it's kind of the booming place back in the day. And I'm not quite sure if someone lives there or not. It's possible. Kind of a rundown looking building, but if you look in the back, you'll actually notice more adobe structures. On the way in, I passed what looked like was mines. There was gated though, and you couldn't get in. And I saw some really old looking stone structures. So I didn't bother stopping because it looks like I couldn't have gotten in. So I'm not sure why everything is all fenced off. Maybe to protect us, I don't know. It's disappointing though. Because this place is so cool and I want to dig in. Maybe I need to make friends with locals. Here's some more old adobe structures. Kind of very overgrown back here. There are, doesn't say no trespassing over here on this side, but evidence of the old ghost town, Shafter Ghost Town. I did read that even in more recent times, they may be opening another mine in this area or reopening a mine. So I don't think they've gotten all the silver out of here. And I've heard that as precious metal prices rise, people are starting to invest in that kind of stuff again. Like back in the old West. What is this? It actually has an open door and like metal rails leading inside. Makes me wonder, is that public? Ah, it's closed off. Yeah, the old adobe bricks, to me, gives away its age. There was a no trespassing sign in the front of this, so I'm not going to trespass. I don't think I'm trespassing now, because I'm not on the other side of any of those fences, but while I'm back here, that is pretty cool looking. And you can see this entire adobe brick wall came tumbling down. It would have been on this side of the house. Yikes. Here's like an old building. Poke my head into there. Can't even see, it's high up, so. I really feel like I must be missing something really obvious, but then again, I don't think I am. I thought this would be an easy one to do, but maybe that is all there is, or all that we're able to see and do. I mean, there's other random structures, don't get me wrong, spread out here and there, but the really dense parts are all barbed wired off here. If you know if it's always been like that, leave me a comment down below or tell me what I'm missing, because I did not do hardcore research on this, so it's making me want to come back, and I saw really intriguing things on the drive-in, like I said. So, who knows? Well, I think this is gonna do it for our very quick tour of West Texas ghost towns. I loved it. I would say Terlingua was my favorite of the bunch. Kept reading that it's, you know, Texas's best ghost town, and I could see why. Definitely really cool. Shafter seems to have a lot to offer, but not sure why everything is fenced off. And that Fort Leaton was really cool. So this was a great day of exploration. I'm so glad you came with me. And if you're into old ghost towns, West Texas has a lot to offer.